Hello and welcome again to the Llangollen Canal in North Wales, where the narrowboat pirate Heidi was about to fire up her air-cooled Lister engine and take me on a short cruise. First of all, there was a quick engine check to do, largely just making sure there's enough oil in there. Then Heidi could turn the key to start the beast. At the back of the boat, Heidi attached the brass tiller arm, which boaters remove when moored so it doesn't get in the way when moving around. It's secured by a tiller pin, which just stays in place through gravity. Many boaters have elaborate, decorative, or meaningful pins, and Heidi is no exception. Before we departed, the fenders were taken up. It's bad form to cruise with them down, as they'll likely get ripped off in the narrow locks, and then end up wrapped around someone's propeller. That done, the mooring rope at the front could be untied and pulled from its chain, which was wrapped around the metal piling on the canal side. Fear not, it didn't fall in the canal. The same again at the back. And then forward gear could be engaged and a bit of throttle to get things moving. You might be thinking Heidi left me behind, which she had, but with good reason, as you'll see in a moment. There's the reason, a lift bridge ahead, which was just around the corner from where we set off. Although I hadn't been left ashore to help so much, but to film as Heidi took the boat through on her own. When I was single-handing my own boat, this kind of thing was very awkward to both do and film at the same time, so I largely didn't. But here, I can show you exactly what you need to do as a solo boater by filming Heidi as she does it. The first part is to step ashore with the centre line and pull the bow of the boat right up to the bridge, because annoyingly the winding controls are on the other side, so once you've crossed and lifted the bridge, you can't return over it to get back to your boat to bring it through. So you have to bring the boat close enough to the bridge to be able to step back aboard from the offside. You'll see what I mean in a second. A standard lock windlass is used to operate the lifting gear, but before we set about that, Heidi grabbed the bow line just in case the boat decided to drift off while the bridge was raised. It doesn't need to be secured, you just need it at hand. Then it was time for some cardio exercise. These things are actually very well geared and counterbalanced, so you don't notice the weight of the bridge at all, but it does take quite a few turns. With the bridge open, they just hold themselves in place, the bow line could be returned, and Heidi could walk along the gunwales to the back. From there, she could bring the boat through the bridge hole. There is, of course, one further annoyance, which is that the bridge is required to be shut behind you, unless there's another boat obviously coming along that also wants to go through, in which case shutting it would be their job. This time it was just us, so after the stern cleared the bridge, Heidi had to bring the boat to a halt. Whereupon she could once again take the bowline ashore, just in case the boat drifted. But unless there's lots of wind, it really won't, so you don't need to get hung up about it. Lowering the bridge is the reverse of raising it. Back aboard, with me also on the gunwales this time, we could set off along the canal. Heidi's boat is very deep drafted at about 3 feet, which in the very shallow canals means it often drags on the mud. And a little bit of threading the needle was required through these moored boats.
I'm glad I could be of assistance at that swing bridge.
Yeah, thanks for your help, David. Oh, it's an easy one. Didn't mind that one. Could have gone a lot worse.
We edged our way slowly past the stationary craft. We were on a little offshoot of the Llangollen called the Prees Branch. It rejoins the main canal at the end of this straight bit. If you weren't already aware, Heidi too makes canal videos over on her YouTube channel, The Narrowboat Pirate. There's a link to it in the video description. Here's the junction where we turned back onto the main line of the Llangollen, heading west. We spotted people wielding chainsaws on the towpath. The stuff of canal-themed horror films, perchance? No, more likely good-hearted volunteers doing their bit to keep the towpath trimmed.
Well, some might say foolishly, Heidi has agreed to let me take the tiller of this behemoth. It's only 57 feet, but it's a deep drafted boat. It's got quite a heavy tiller and you really feel the boat as you're trying to steer it. But it's good fun. I was just saying to Heidi as she's standing on the side of the boat here that this being the pirate boat, perhaps I should just push her overboard and claim the boat as my own. In the proper pirate tradition.
There's a long straight section here that's up on an embankment above the level of the fields either side. Just think of the manual labour involved in building this a couple of hundred years ago. Eventually, you reach the end of the strait and take a very long left turn. You can see how high the embankment is if you peer into the distance. I popped inside to warm my hands by the stove. It was a chilly day. And that visit below lets you see why side hatches are such a popular aspect of a narrowboat, giving you the benefits of the view whilst enabling you to keep warm. We approached our first bridge of the day, number 47 on the canal map. an overflow for the canal slips off to the left. It's one of the ways that canals are prevented from flooding, by and large. I could have done with a woolly coat like these sheep. Mooring on the towpath side is open to all, but on the offside is generally private land. I always wanted an offside mooring on a canal. All the pleasure of a scenic place to stay, but no random people on the towpath peering in through your windows.
I've taken to the tiller once again, as we not only go past moored boats, but also approach a bridge. And Heidi, being very trusting, has gone down inside to make a cup of tea. And going very slowly.
The trouble is, I'm quite confident when I take the tiller, and that's exactly the kind of pompous self-belief that can end up getting you into trouble when you're too blasé. These are canal and river trust moorings. The symbols on the sign mean there's a water point and waste disposal facilities. Although only the water point is marked on the CRT's online map, I notice. Just as we approached Bridge 48, a little voice piped up from down below.
Oh, that'd be lovely.
With butter on?
That'd be even better.
I'm pleased to say I made it through the bridge hole, which are always barely inches wider than the boat, with those inches to spare. A private mooring and a shed. What more could a chap ever want? Heaven! Here's the perfect complement to that mooring, tiny narrowboats. I am so envious of my friend Lorna buying one. By hook or by crook, I must get a tiny boat somehow. Both Heidi and I were enjoying our hot cross buns and a warming cuppa.
Cheers. No rum. Too early.
You know, the mark of a confident boater is when they're happy to go inside via the side hatch while the boat is moving, and taking plates too. One thing I very much appreciated on Heidi's boat was this raised step, which gives you super visibility as you steer. Alas, mostly my visibility was of darkening clouds, with the odd raindrop to sour the mood too. As we came around this bend, Heidi spotted another boat approaching and took back the tiller in case I rammed them, presumably. Heidi has the most marvellous horn. It was another trading boat, and as we passed, it turned out they had a gift for Heidi sent by a viewer of her videos. Passing it over necessitated manoeuvres worthy of the Red Arrow's display team.
Hey, off to?
What church? For the weekend.
We set off again. You can't quite make them out, but there are huge metal pilings behind the ones you can see at the edge of the canal that are holding the embankment in place. The fields below show how high we are. And then, after a morning in which we'd seen no other boats, suddenly it was all traffic the other way. With a friend of Heidi's, artist Jan Valance, coming towards us. This warranted another greeting.
Ahoy, me hearty!
With rain spots becoming more frequent, and our stomachs indicating it was lunchtime, notwithstanding the hot cross buns, we decided to look for a spot to stop. A winding hole or turning point was coming up soon, with a place to moor just next to it, so that was our target. The winding hole was just after the bridge, which was just after this bend. The modern bridges just don't quite have the same appeal as the classic ones, do they? This is the winding hole. You can see how it gets wider on the left, so you could turn a boat round here if needed. Just beyond it, there are some visitor moorings. Once again, I gallantly watched and filmed as Heidi did the mooring up, stepping off with the centre line to bring the boat in and to a halt. The boats do move easily enough when you haul on the rope, but you do need a degree of agility and strength to do this. Being an official visitor mooring, we found rings to tie to, embedded in the ground. As the boat sat in place, Heidi dropped the fenders, tied the boat to the rings, and turned the engine off. This was a very nice spot, with neighbours ahead for a bit of company, and swans too, having a lovely meal of grass. Yum! This was our view. Thanks for watching. Cheerio.